Problems I had, baby, 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 it was yours, just like it was mine, sugar. It was my problem, baby, too. Little girl, that's why I'm not gonna let you be, baby.
Back on the corner again, back I belong, where I've always been. Everything the same, you don't ever change. Back on the corner again, and heal again, and heal again.
Down those ancient streets, down those ancient roads, where nobody knows, where nobody goes. Back on the corner again, everything the same. That don't ever change. Yeah. In a healing game.
What a homeboy sang, singing songs of praise for the golden day. And to heal again, to heal again. Heal. Sing it out loud. Sing it like you're proud. Sing it in your name, your name. Sing, heal again.
Well, the homeboys sing, sing the songs of praise. How about the golden days? Oh, I'm in a healing game. Sing it out loud. Sing it like your power. Sing it in your name. Hey, Lord, sing me the healing. Well, Backstreet Jelly Roll.
Big Ten Jelly Roll, Jelly Roll.
Oh, in a healing game.
In a healing game. In a healing game.
Sing the healing game.
Sing the healing game.
Sing the healing game.
Sing the healing game. Sing the healing game.
Sing it in your name.
Sing it in your name. Your name.
Sing me the healing game.
Sing me. Sing me the healing game.
Healing game.
Healing game. To hear it again, hear it again.
Oh, when I walked her home.
When I walked her home.
When I walked her home.
When I walked her
again.
When I walked her home. In the hill again.
When I walked her home.
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 I'm in the healing game.
When the healing game.
Everything's the same.
Everything's the same thing.
It don't ever change.
It don't ever change. Don't ever change.
Back on the corner again.
Back on the corner again.
I'm in the healing game.
I'm in the healing game.
I'm in the healing game.
I'm in the healing game. Healing game.
I'm in the healing game.
I'm in the healing game. Healing game.
Sing it in your name.
Sing it in your name. Sing it in your name.
In the healing game.
I'm 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 in the healing game.
Is it getting better? Do you feel the same? Will it make it easier on you now? You've got someone to blame. Sharing leaves you, darling, if you don't care for it. Did I disappoint you? Leave a bad taste in your mouth. You act like you never had love, and you want me to go without. Well, it's too late tonight to drag the past out into the light. We're one, but we're not the same. We get to carry each other, carry each other. Whoa, whoa. Forgiveness. Have you come to raise the dead? Have you come here to play Jesus to the lepers in your head? Well, did I ask too much? More than a lot. You gave me nothing, now it's all I got.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we are ready to go, and we have our panelists here, and we want to ask the question, how to make infrastructure fit for the clean vehicle revolution. So, Lars, you know, from Volvo, we're delighted that Axel Walker is with us now, team leader for Clean Transport DG Move at the European Commission. Then we have Matthias Mirja, who is the General Delegate to the EU for the World Road Transport Organization, so representing the road transport associations and the operators. Next to him we have Johan Peters, who is the Global VP for Sales and Marketing Electrical Vehicle Infrastructure for ABB, of course a big player in electrical vehicle charging infrastructure. I saw that the Fortune magazine ranked ABB 8 on its list of companies, and I thought it said that are charging the world, but it actually says changing the world in electric vehicle charging, so welcome to you. Then we have Neil Valentine, Head of Division of Urban Mobility at the European Investment Bank, or the Climate Bank, we are now hearing that you should be called, so we'll talk some more about that. The man with the money. And then we have Aubrey Trong, who is the Director of Green Mobility at ENGIE. ENGIE, you're all very familiar, I'm sure, French multinational utility company, as well as electricity, we're talking natural gas, nuclear, my microphone's just fallen off. renewable energy, and also you are developing some charging infrastructure, I think, but not exactly. I think more for cars, so we'll get into that a little bit. So, Axel, you are here. We are delighted you're here. So you are now going to be put on in the spotlight straight away, because I really want to get a sense of, first of all, just how important an issue is this from the Commission's perspective. Obviously, it's difficult, I know, because we're going into a new Commission. We're going to have a different Commissioner. But just how important is the whole issue of charging infrastructures, refueling for heavy-duty vehicles in particular we're talking today?
Thank you, and good morning. And first of all, I need to apologize to the organizers and to all of you for not being able to be here on time this morning. These are a little bit of hectic and difficult times at the moment, and there were some last-minute hiccups. So, coming back to your question, I think it is of strong importance, and you can take the importance for the Commission from the fact that the first bullet in the mandate letter for the Transport Commissioner, for the new Transport Commissioner, actually refers to action to accelerate the uptake of alternative fuels. So that gives you a clear indication where the President-elect, the Commission President-elect, sees the role and relevance of work on alternative fuels in the context of the new Transport Commissioner.
So we don't know who that new Commissioner is going to be yet?
No, we don't know it, but we are pretty sure that we will have it soon, and then we can start working on that ambitious mandate.
And the Alternative Fuels Infrastructure Directive, we talked a little bit about it before. I mean, do you have an idea yet what might be new in it? What new elements?
So, I mean, we have started the evaluation of the directive. And so, you know, in the Commission, we have a standard procedure. We evaluate a piece of legislation, and we make an impact assessment and come forward with a proposal.
So when you evaluate it and you look at since 2014, it's been more or less ignored by a lot of countries, hasn't it?
I think you have to come there to a more differentiated assessment. So if you go back to 2013-14, we really had a completely different market situation. In fact, alternative fuels was really nowhere in many, many member states. And I think the directive, which was rather early on in its time, has helped to steer a discussion in many member states about, well, a principal way forward and understanding of how are we going to deal with alternative fuels. So in that sense, it was good, and we see, you know, national policy frameworks we have now in all the member states. They are discussing measures, what they want to do. And of course, it has not, as we said already 2 years ago in our assessment of these national frameworks, not fully delivered up to the kind of intentions the co-legislator had when the directive was adopted. Yes.
So it's not fully delivered. So we'll talk some more about that in a moment. Matthias, let's get the perspective from the operator. How important is this whole issue to you? And I mean, how do you sort of see the future in terms of how your trucks are going to be fueled?
Thank you, Cathy. Very important. And I'm very pleased to be here because I use the voice of more than 3.5 million transport operators worldwide. We're the social partner and the employer organization for road transport operators. And I would like to shift your attention, I come back to the word shift because it's very important to me, back to the fact that, or we should maybe ask the question, is energy transition actually the low-hanging fruit to decarbonize our sector? I will pick up the Commission for sure moving forward, as we did last week in our dinner debate in Parliament, where we presented our manifesto on stopping the modal shift policy for the simple reason that we need to do modal cooperation. There is, I think, 1.3 billion cars in the world. If you make all of them electric, the CO2 reduction, if you really make the calculation right, is about 4%. 4%. We talk about high-capacity trucks, buses and coaches replacing cars, 30 to 40% CO2 reduction tomorrow, without even talking about energy transition. Don't get me wrong, it's very important, but we have to recalibrate sometimes in the discussion and actually realize what are the low-hanging fruits that we can pick tomorrow.
But assuming that you have picked those low-hanging fruits, looking forward and beyond that,
sure.
Then do you see electricity as the future?
Again, let me just conclude on my first thought. High-capacity transport and trade facilitation. Trade is equally important. There is about more than 100,000 trucks going over the Turkish EU border every day, more than 100,000. I visited a border crossing point, half of the registration plates in a queue of 1,500 trucks, EU, with engines running in the Turkish heat, and we talk about zero emission. Now, let me come back to energy. Is battery the solution? I don't know. Lars picked up very nicely on all of the options that we can use as operators. The problem essentially lies in the fact that operators don't know what's coming. And we cannot afford to invest in two or three trucks to do the job of one truck, only because we don't know what the Uber is here, or what the urban access restriction is there, or what the infrastructure capability is in that country or in that country. It is absolutely not clear to us at the moment. And I would like to also provoke a bit in the sense that we are buying every day, every hour, up to 1,000 trucks per hour in Europe. And we talk about technologies that are not on the market yet, and we talk about investing in infrastructure where we don't know if it's actually going to solve any of our issues towards 2030. We have to do something right now. We see strong inroads of gas trucks. Thousands of units are being put in the market right now, including from your brand, from Volvo. Thank you very much. I think it's an interesting product. We talk about electric. Hauliers at the moment invest in electric only in a handful of cases. And they do it, sorry to be frank again, you mentioned transport buyers. It's very important. The transport buyer, the shipper, is maybe interested in going zero or lowering emissions. But the transport operator will have to then channel the question back and say, okay, dear transport buyer, since the vehicle is 300,000-400,000, are you prepared to pay me double or triple? And in most cases, the answer is no. So it's a bit more complicated than that.
Okay.
And I think batteries also have many questions that I would like to see clarified in terms of a big CO2 backpack before even driving a single kilometer. So we need a holistic approach. And that's why IRU wants to see also a well-to-wheel discussion emerging into a life cycle discussion, because we shouldn't stop looking at the tailpipe exclusively. That would be wrong.
Okay, well, let's hear what Johan has got to say about ABB, because, I mean, you will say that we can offer a solution to the hauliers with your infrastructure. Tell us what you're actually doing and how you see the future.
Okay, so I'm coming from a startup company in the Netherlands called Appion, which was acquired by ABB in 2010. So I'm coming from a startup, and in 2009, we decided, let's see if we can charge vehicles. In 2009, there were no electric cars, was not existing. And in 2010, we took the first vehicle, we took the motor out, put an electric motor in, and so on. And where we are now today, so from 2010, the first electric cars, Nissan Leaf, Mitsubishi IMEF, we were talking at that time 50 kilowatt charging. We still had discussions, it's slow charging and so on. We were talking 50 kilowatt charging. If you would have told me at that time, 10 years ago, that today we are charging with 350 kilowatt on the road, we're doing it today, I would not have believed it at all. I would say you're nuts. Today we're doing it. So, and what we're seeing now is where we are with electric cars, and I can guarantee you, we can have discussion about CO2 and all of these things and difficult calculations. But the reality is that if we compare this with trucks where we are now and electric cars, 10 years ago, electric car was really not good. Today, I can guarantee if you drive an electric car, I mean, it's the best experience ever. We can discuss about pricing and so on. We are solving that. We are at the same point with trucks where we were with cars 10 years ago. And the speed of development we have seen over the last 10 years was tremendous. So today, we are installing every single day chargers for electric cars which have a power of 350 kilowatt all over Europe. With the help of the European Commission, we are doing that, so based on TEN-T. What we're doing right now is that we see the request from truck makers because of policy. They say we need to have the right infrastructure to charge our trucks. And then it's a very simple calculation. If you have a certain distance you need to travel, a certain payload, then you can calculate the amount of energy needed to bring that truck from A to B. And then it's a very simple calculation, how much power do I need? And this calculation we have done together with all the truck makers, including Tesla, Volvo, Daimler, everybody. And the conclusion is, okay, for long haul, if we have to do that, then we come to a number somewhere in the range of 2 megawatt charging. So also the time you need to do it quickly. So the magic number, consensus in the industry, is somewhere around 2 megawatt. So we went back within the charging group and said, okay, let's define a charging system which can do that. And we are now standardizing high power charging. We have defined the, and this is not ABB, this is really the industry, the suppliers of charging equipment, but also the OEMs. So this is really, and now we need to make sure Europe is also following, because we are going a little bit ahead. And so we have defined the new standard, more or less. And I can explain more later, because
But it sounds, though, you're saying, okay, you're charging ahead, and the OEMs are busy making the trucks, but if Matthias is not going to buy them, it's pointless. You're going to have a network of white elephants.
Okay, and we had the same discussion. I'm not selling drugs, so that's a question you have to ask.
But the point is that the point is that the trucks have to be bought to use your network, and at the moment what we're hearing from the operators is that they're not really that interested.
There was the same 10 years ago with electric cars. What I want to say is we are at the same point where we were with electric vehicles. It will take time, for sure. But there is no doubt in my mind that this will happen for long haul with these power levels. We are developing the infrastructure. The trucks are in development. They will come. The question is, when will they hit the road? I expect the first trucks.
For which use case? For which use case is very important.
For what use case? But in the end, it's also about what's the cost. But look to electric cars. I'm not selling trucks or cars. I don't know the operators, which is so. But in the end, because of dropping battery prices, technology is super good. These cars can be automated. So it will happen, absolutely. And if you ask me, what technology will it be? I believe it will be electric.
Okay, so clearly you're convinced. Let's hear from the European Investment Bank, because you are already working in this field. Tell us a little bit about what you do. What is your policy towards supporting the fueling infrastructure and charging infrastructure?
So the bank's interest is obviously in decarbonisation of the transport industry generally. We're effectively technology neutral, and we're also very importantly promoter-led. So borrowers need to bring projects to us. We don't create projects. So people on this panel and in the audience whose member state, whose company, whose region has a project, approach us with a business plan. So business plans need to be credible. And I think the analogy with electric vehicles is useful, because it gives us a comparison. And in any change, you're scrabbling around trying to understand what's happening and at what point are things going to start tipping. And what we saw was that we got involved with the Commission a number of years ago, promoting cleaner transport, and there was a huge need for sharing of information, for dissemination of best practice, of making people aware of what was available, and importantly, helping people with some grants. And the Commission has channeled money into clean vehicle deployment through the Connecting Europe facility. And the bank has also had some money from the Commission for guarantee purposes. So in this transition period of early deployment, we've been able to help some of the early business cases, if you like.
Do you actually support diesel at the moment? Or when you say that you're technology neutral,
So the bank has, like the Commission, like a lot of us, have recently been tossed up in the air and shaken around by our politicians. And that's obviously an uncomfortable thing, but I think it's, you referred to the climate bank. I mean, it's no secret that the European leaders want the bank to do more. Macron was the one who started the ball rolling with Europe needs a climate bank, and somebody said, hang on a minute, we've got the EIB who already does 25% of its lending in climate. Why don't we just get them to do some more, please?
So is that what you will be doing in future?
The ambition, our president has been talking to van der Leyen, the new president of the Commission. There will be more cooperation with the Commission in some of their programs for the next MFF. But importantly, the bank, I believe President Hoyer's commitment was to $1 trillion of climate over the investment over the next 10 years. So I mean that's really, you know, setting out our stall. Now, what does that mean? And he also said that everything we would do would be Paris-aligned. Now, this is all relatively new. I mean, it was the end of September at the UN conference on climate that these statements were made. So of course, the services are all running around trying to understand what that means. What it means practically is that the goalposts have changed. The way everybody is looking at projects from our boards to the commission to the other funding institutions is through a climate lens. So we first look at, does this make sense from a climate perspective? And then we look at the economic viability and the proposal of the project. And if it's not economically viable, what's the problem? And what kind of support does it need?
So potentially, there will be then potentially more funding available, financial instruments, guarantees, or whatever, for infrastructure projects.
Absolutely, yes. But I can't tell you today what they are,
yeah,
because we're still in the process of discussing them. I can tell you what we've done up till now, which has been interesting. We've been active predominantly in the bus deployment space, public transport. It was a good place to start. It's relatively small, a lot of public authorities. But I mean, the Commission have just successfully had the Clean Vehicle Directive through Parliament. So that's now on the statute book, and I believe comes into effect in 2 years' time, which forces public authorities to buy cleaner vehicles. There's a sliding scale depending on which member state you are, but broadly speaking, about half of new vehicles need to be alternative fuel in public sector use. That's a vast number of vehicles every year. Mm-hmm. These are the sorts of levers that are causing, you know, the people on this panel to succeed or fail, depending on what their view of the world is.
Okay, well, a lot of power in the EIB there. From the perspective of ENGIE, tell us a little bit more, because I mean, you're a utility company, but you are now branching out into charging stations.
Yes. Thank you, Cathy. I'm very pleased to be here and to explain a bit what ENGIE does, and also what we see, I would say, directly from the field, and also what our customers request from us. So as you know, we are an energy utility, but not only, we're also providing services, and we also install some of your chargers for some bus operators, and we are very happy to do this. So where are we coming from? We are coming, I would say, initially from the gas world, but you know that today, as part of the energy transition, when you want to transition to zero carbon, you have to adopt, I would say, different fuels, and this is what we see from the field. So today, we are, I would say, especially in France, one of the leading operators in terms of compressed natural gas, liquefied natural gas. We have been working, I would say, over the past 2 years with all the car makers to provide them with charging stations for the cars that will be sold in the dealership starting from next year. And we have been also experimenting on hydrogen, and we have been very happy to commission the second hydrogen fueling station for bus rapid transit lines in the south of France early this month. So I will say that we see this wide spectrum of clean energies, and what we have to focus on is what I would say our customers and what our users in fact request from us. By the end of the day, the request for electricity comes mainly, I would say, for cars and for fleet of cars, and also for utility vans. So it's mainly last kilometer access to city center. It has been driven mainly, and especially in one particular city in France, to the fact that the municipality decided to announce that they will ban diesel for the access to the city center by 2025. So it's a very strong, I would say, statement that forces all the operators, in fact, to consider, I would say, new ways of driving green to enter the city. And then we have, I would say, the transport operators who also have, I would say, this issue of going into the clean fuels, but also being economically sound. They do not want to confuse the end of the world with the end of the month. The question is, we have transport companies who are requesting from the transport buyers, I would say, to go green, but the question is, what is the most economically sound available solution today to go green while still being competitive, because it's a very competitive market. So for them, I would say natural gas, whether compressed, whether liquefied, is the best choice available today. And tomorrow we see this more and more, there will be biogas, because today we see that in France, I would say you have 12% of biogas that are consumed for the transport. So it's very, I would say, a virtuous circle, because it means that at some point of time, we will have also the biogas production that will arise, I would say, for the agricultural sector, which is quite important to keep these employment capabilities locally. The third thing is hydrogen. Hydrogen, for now, it's pilot projects. We have been, I would say, commissioning these stations, as I said. We have many more other projects which are much more, I would say, ecosystem plays of hydrogen, using hydrogen not only for mobility, but also for industry, for also other usage, always green hydrogen. The question mainly is that today, it's mainly, I would say, the municipalities who take these decisions. Because there are no real business model today and the economics are not yet here. I truly believe that hydrogen has a role to play in the energy mix. The question is, how do we foster, I would say, the adoption of these clean fuels? So making really for the customer and for the user, I would say, both easy to use, but also economically sound, so that over the long term, he can operate safely, and for us as suppliers and the whole ecosystems to provide the best solutions, in fact, to meet the targets.
Okay, well, thank you. So, I mean, there seems to be so many choices to be made out there. Do we have to leave it open, or should we be targeting on one way of fueling HDV? Should we go, what do you think, Lars? I mean,
no, I'm rather convinced that it's far too early to, I've said it before, there is not one silver bullet. We need to have a lot of options open. We need to continue to develop several different technologies in parallel, a sort of menu, a sort of buffet to choose from for different applications. It would be extremely dangerous to go for one solution.
But from the Commission's perspective, Axel, the time is not on anyone's side in this, is it? I mean, you used that lovely phrase, don't confuse the end of the world with the end of the month. But, I mean, people are talking about, a climate catastrophe that we're heading towards. So in terms of how legislation can push, and would the Commission decide to get off the, you've always said that you also want to be technology neutral, but maybe you now will make a decision that you want to go down one particular route.
I cannot speak on behalf of the incoming Commission. I mean, so far the Commission has and probably will continue to use a technological neutral approach that is looking at emission savings. I fully agree with Lars, with what you were saying, Lars. I mean, in our long-term climate strategy, we also clearly put forward a sentence, and that is electrification has a lot of potential for certain parts of the segment, particularly in the light-duty segment, but it is not the silver bullet. And particularly in the heavy-duty sector, we will see a prolongation of a different technology options, and then it will be for the market to decide also on the use case what kind of technology to use. We already see, for example, in urban and interurban delivery, a much stronger momentum on electrification than we have seen 2 years ago. So that analogy might well come. When we look into long distance, I think we also see a lot of interest, but also a lot of question marks. And, when we speak about what is the future network needs, we speak about 2 megawatt chargers. I think technologically that is feasible, but we also need to integrate these chargers into the overall energy system. So that's a completely new challenge compared to what we are facing now with the 175 kilowatt chargers. But just let me maybe make one remark to Matthias before we close on your thing. I think you're absolutely right. And I think that the Commission has always said, and we said so in the low emission mobility strategy in 2016, and we have also shown it in our long-term climate strategy scenarios, that we need emission reductions to come from all sources. So we've put a lot of emphasis on a better optimization, truly increasing the efficiency of the transport system, which is why digitalization and intelligent transport systems and good connection of different modes is very important. Whether it is a low-hanging fruit, I would put a question mark. I think it's a fruit, and you also have to put quite a lot of effort to grab it. And then we have the issue of low-emission alternative energies and zero and low-emission vehicle technologies that we need to bring into the market. And if you look into our long-term decarbonization scenarios, you'll see that we have to manage a transition. And we have to manage a transition by which around 2050 we have reached a 90% emission reduction. And we need to see the interplay of road together with waterborne, with aviation, and with rail. And that also puts a new sort of connotation to alternative fuels, because, for example, when we speak about biogas, where we have limitations, where do we use it best? If we speak about biofuels, where we have limitations, where do we use them best? And how much can we make use of electrification? How quickly can we really bring in hydrogen fuel cell drivetrains into the market, which are still in a very kind of not satisfying early stage of maturity? And that means for us as regulators, so we'll have two clear objectives on AFID. We will have to address, in a good cooperation with the stakeholders, both the topic of quantity and quality. So we need to ensure that we have sort of the infrastructure in sufficient numbers to ensure that this kind of alternative powertrain shift can work out. But it also needs to be quality. So we need to have interoperability. We need to have easy to use, seamless services. And that is the same for heavy duty as it is for light duty. You know? We don't want a truck driver to cope with the different mechanisms, different tools on his way through Europe. So it needs to be an easy system. So just to please to say, it is not only the question how many recharging points and what kind of charging points we have on the road, but also what is the overall ecosystem in which they operate. And that needs to be easy, seamless, interoperable to use.
But the charging stations are still important, though, and in the revision of the directive, if we're talking about speeding up this transition period that we're in, do you not think then that there has to be binding targets for member states to adhere to, which there weren't in the first version of the directive?
So, as you know, I mean, the Commission, in its original proposal in 2013, proposed binding targets, and that at the point in time was not accepted by the co-legislator. Now, pending the priority setting of the new commission, pending the work program, we will be working on the evaluation and then the further review of the directive. And in that, we will clearly look into the question of binding targets. But it is not a simple discussion. No? I mean, it is not to say, you know, you can set one binding target to cover them all. I mean, that's not really the case. We have a network which is very diverse in its operation. You have different traffic flow, you have different traffic demand situations throughout Europe, and you cannot put that all under one sort of line. So I think this is why we are still sort of looking into this, we are still analyzing it, and it is far too early to say, you know, okay, let's do it like that. So I think that will be an open discussion.
Lars.
It's good, Axel, but if you don't put the mandatory demands on the member states, you have to have another mechanism in place so that you and I and the rest of us, that we feel confident that 2022, 23, 24, we have the infrastructure. Because, you know, with the legislation that we have upcoming towards 2025, we need to have electric trucks on the road. Yeah. And it would be embarrassing if you and me were sitting on a panel debate 2024 apologizing to the planet. The trucks are ready, but we didn't have any infrastructure. So that's something you need to bring home to your colleagues.
Yes. So just then let me return the invitation. We'll have an open public consultation on the evaluation of the directive starting early in 2020. So that is your chance to make that statement from Volvo clear and loud. And then we'll see in the aftermath where we will land.
We will be there.
Johan.
I would like to add something. It's really surprising that the industry, being the OEMs, the truck makers, the infrastructure providers, energy, we are doing it. It's we are defining specs without Europe. So this is happening. If you'd like it or not, so it would be really a shame that the effort which is put in by Volvo and all the truck makers, the infrastructure providers, we are running even ahead of legislation. And we have seen the same with electric cars. We had the Japanese standard entering Europe. They made the fight for Shademo CCS
we are in exactly the same situation. And I think the Commission is slow here. I think the industry is going much faster. And I think that the momentum is there. And yes, the business models, initially it will be hard, it will be better, and in the end it will be cheaper. I'm so convinced about that. But I think Commission should step
and,
up.
And the Commission is slow, but you know, if we think about the European Parliament, with more Greens in the Parliament now, there will be pressure from other places, won't there, in terms of the Commission? I mean, so how do you respond to the fact that you're slow?
So first of all, I think I rather prefer to be in a situation where the industry is running ahead, and as a legislator, you can then create a sort of the comprehensive framework to accommodate that, than to have the other way around.
But it's happening.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying when we were in 2013, I think it was the other way around. The Commission came with a very ambitious policy, which was probably too early for its time, and then the market, you know, reacted nowhere, maybe a little bit around, and I think that situation is much more comfortable. Then on the question of being slow or not, I would kind of disagree with that, because I think, as Neil was also saying, I mean, we've done a lot over the last 3 to 4 years to really help build this initial base of infrastructure on which the market can now draw and evolve.
Well, there are no charging places stations on Europe's motorways for heavy-duty vehicles.
But I want to help here, so it's not all that negative. I think on cars, we went through the whole process, 2009 to where we are today.
Totally different case.
One moment. But we learned a lot. We learned from the mistakes. If you're not very early on defined the standard, you get this kind of strange situation. We had that. Okay, then at a certain moment, we started to put different plugs on chargers, which is really a shame. It's the same energy, the same electrons, but different plugs and different protocols. So I think we need to avoid it. The good news is, the very good news is that on a worldwide level, okay, but let's forget China. It's always difficult.
Dangerous thing to do.
Because they do their own thing, independent of whatever you decide on standardization. And also on safety, yeah? So it has to be safe and easy to use. And I think there, Europe, as well as USA, I think there we are really ahead of the game. It has to be safe. So the point I want to make is that the work is ongoing in full synchronization between, I would say, all of the European and North American truck builders. So we are meeting together with the infrastructure providers. So that work is ongoing. And we're coming now to consensus about power levels and plugs. That is happening. So the uncertainty about what will it be is disappearing very, very quickly. So we know this. Now, what I want to say is also to the Commission, we are now reaching the point that with quite certainty we can say this is at least from, okay, I'm not talking hydrogen, there similar works can be done there as well, but at least on the electrification side, there will be a golden standard for North America, Europe. That is happening. So I think this would be the time for the Commission to step in. I think that the time is now to help.
But it's also the time that we've got to convince Matthias and the truck operators. What's your view of this?
I think we need an evolution and not a revolution, just to say the least, on what's happening. And let's discuss what is happening or what will be happening. We don't even talk about, operators don't think annually or monthly, they think daily. And you have to do a job tomorrow. So if we make a naive assessment of the situation and build castles in the air by hoping on something, let the operators prove it first on the market. I think if you talk about batteries, it's undisputed that there is something coming on urban, or maybe even as Volvo is looking into regional 150 kilometers. But as with all the information we have today, we don't know if the battery, is the solution or if it's only a transition. What happens if gas makes strong inroads and you convince the operators that it actually works? What happens if hydrogen trucks come on the market in a few years? Will we stop talking about batteries on heavy vehicles? I think there is a discussion to have, and it should be honest. And you can never trick physics and chemistry, never. And Lars, I'm not an engineer, but I know you know perfectly. If you talk about energy content, and you have 43 megajoule per liter of diesel, why do you use gas? Because it has 46. Why do you have difficulties to talk battery? Because lithium-ion batteries is 0.36, a difference and a factor difference of 120 times less energy. If we talk about legislation and we review the Duffy, I don't know if we should push for 20,500 kilowatt-hour high charging points on the 10T network. I don't know. It's certainly a very, very tricky question to ask. And then you have a discussion on energy taxation. If I may, just the last comment. Yeah. We will also, Lars will maybe be the first one to participate in the public consultation. I will be the second. Energy transition, the Commission failed because you set a ridiculously low price on CO2 and you charged energy. The haulage business needs energy. We need for long distance, also for coaches, we need energy content. If you penalize energy content, which is the lifeblood of the economy, by at the same time marginalizing the impact of CO2, you have to make smart legislation. And the carbon price was 20 tons. In the negotiations, it was watered down to 12 tons. You want to make it right? Set the carbon price at 200.
But could you be convinced if there were
better fuels is my point, actually. We need better fuels, not only a discussion on how do we exchange one tank with another.
This is too easy. This I've heard many times, the energy density, absolutely. Liquid fuels, gas has the highest energy density, absolutely. But it's super inefficient. And you need to bring the efficiency in the equation. So the best diesel engine, I don't know, 20% maybe. So it's super inefficient, so you have to compare the two.
50.
Or 50.
Use 50.
Oh, it's very high. Oh. But also recuperation and so on. And if you talk about hydrogen, you also have to look, where do I get it from? And how do I produce it? And so you need to bring all those elements into the total equation. And then maybe the discussion is a little bit different. So be careful just saying about energy density.
If I may, I think it will be a mix. And I fully support Volvo on this. You need a myriad of solutions because the transport sector is a basket full of services and 10 vehicles to do 10 different jobs. Mm. And that may require maybe not 10, but 5 different or 3 different solutions.
Let me see if there are any questions from the audience and any thoughts, any questions? You're all very, very quiet. Yes, we have a question.
All confused.
Do we have a microphone, please? Do we have a microphone for the audience? Yeah. If you'd like to put your hand up, sir.
Thank you, Frank Peters. Thank you very much. It's a super interesting discussion. And clearly,
you're from?
Yeah, I'm a management consultant. We work in the transport and sustainable energy business, and we're advising large industry clients on where to invest, where not to invest, and how transport, what they need to prepare for the future. Okay. I think a key point, which is made by several people, and you also, Lars, is the diversity. And we are much too early to find out who's the winner, winning energy, and the losing one. So we need to have a broad basket. But this is exactly the point that you address, Matthias, rightfully for the industry, which is a pain. Because everybody's talking about that. We're not really putting a price tag on. We just know, should I invest in hydrogen? Should I invest in biodiesel or biofuel? Should I go for gas? Should I go for electricity? You will never get a transport company to invest in 4 or 5 different solutions at the same time. You will never get an end customer buying a milk in the Delhaize to pay four, five different things. Let's be realistic. I mean, buying an electric car is something personal. You can have your own image to have a Tesla. And by the way, the guys who buy a Tesla, and I'm from Denmark, it's because we bought it because we were heavily subsidized by the government. The moment the subsidy was away, we didn't buy that anymore. So let's not be blunt. Let's just look at it. At the end of the day, it's cool cash, nothing else. And I think this is where we need an answer on how to promote and simply minimize the risk for people who want to embark and want to drive and learn.
Right, well, let's make that your question then. How do we promote and how do we...
And minimize the risk.
How do we minimize the risk? Because clearly that's a big risk to you. I mean, Ulrik, do you have any thoughts on that?
Yes, I would say that I really like the question because it relates to our first statement by saying, by the end of the day, I would say it's not, I would say, imposing something on customers, on users of clean fuels. It's convincing them that it's good for them, and I would say for the economy sector, for the transport company, is that it makes, I would say, an economical sense to them. What we have seen today, I would say, for trucks in France is that we, I would say, saw an increase of 80% of sales of natural gas trucks between 2017 and 2018. And what happened is that we had, I would say, a very favorable policy at the national level, I would say, to make it, I would say, economically sound for the transport companies to operate them. It went through, I would say, regulations saying, okay, I would say we will have low emission zones, and clearly, I would say, to deliver to the city centers, to deliver goods to the city centers, then it will require, I would say, to use clean fuels and to have clean vehicles. But it's not only the regulation that does it, because by the end of the day, it leaves you, I would say, with the issue of how do I do it economically. So it means that the French government made the decision to give this visibility and to say, okay, look, for natural gas, if you're using it for trucks, then you will have an excess tax. It will increase, but compared to, I would say, before what happened, I would say, last autumn, but it will be, I would say, quite low in terms of increase because of the CO2 content of the gas compared to the diesel to the CO2 content of diesel. So it means that you have a high visibility on the prices, and it was issued for 4 years, and we really hope that it will continue, because it answers, in fact, to the question that you have to say, as a transport company, if the transport buyer is not willing to pay me, in fact, to convert to clean fuels, at least by choosing this fuel, I should be able to compute my break-even, to know where I will earn money, if I'm at risk or not. This is exactly what you're saying, minimizing the risk of the operating cost. And I think that by triggering this and also allowing, I would say, a special measure in France, which is overt amortization, meaning that the excess price of the vehicle by going to natural gas can be amortized into the accounts, meaning that more or less, I would say, for transport company, is the same price as buying a diesel vehicle than a natural gas vehicle. This support is necessary at the beginning. It will phase out, we know it, but at least if you can say that for 4 years, 5 years, 7 years, depending on the countries, depending on how comfortable you are, by providing this visibility, it will help to build the business case. Because by the end of the day, and I exactly agree with what you say, it needs to be a positive business case, or whether in fact you are helping at the beginning by also, we have it in France, I would say, some financial support to develop both the supply and the demand, both the fueling station, but also the purchase of the vehicles. It's only, I would say, through this kickstart that it will happen. And today in France, we see it happening. As I said, we have 80%, I would say, more orders of trucks, and more the transport buyers are also coming to this because, I would say, as you say, the retailers, they are very keen to say, to drive, I would say, in the cities and to, I would say, put, I would say, your branding on the trucks and to say, okay, I'm driving CO2 free to bring you your goods to home. We will have it, I would say, for the goods, whether I would say it's fresh food, but also, in fact, for all the packets that need to be delivered now. When I'm ordering on Amazon today, I'm not expecting, I would say, to be shipped via a container and to spend 1 month at sea. I want it, I would say, tomorrow or in the hour. So clearly, we need to have these business models that work for the customers.
Matthias,
you asked what you have to do to bring this to the market. Incentivize, don't penalize. I mean, you now see it in the Euro vignette. There is zero earmarking. Member states would like to pump money into railways. 20% of electricity is renewable. You only have the truck at the end of the day, plus railway. So we talk modal cooperation. Just when you talk modal shift, and that's my most important question to the Commission, are you actually not wondering, or are you actually not aware that by talking about shifting, which is in reality not possible, maritime, aviation, rail, and over the last two decades, volumes have doubled. In terms of trucking, we're still on the same volume level of post-World War II. I'm very sorry, and we talk about shifting. The moment you talk about shifting, and all demand keeps growing, you said it, Lars, you give road transport a very negative reputation, and member states will pump more money that they earn in the road sector into other modes. If you want to use all of that stuff, innovate, let the industry innovate, and leave the money in our industry. That's my most important remark.
But clearly, your image can be improved by becoming greener and greener.
We have to. And as you know, I didn't give you the facts and numbers, but if you look at Germany released from the German Environmental Agency, something which was based on the price of 180 euros per ton of CO2. The result was the diesel coach is 100% per passenger kilometer, 100% cleaner than the electric train. The diesel truck is 40% cleaner in terms of CO2 than the electric train based on ton kilometer. These are facts. But we want to go beyond that and also talk together about how we can replace diesel. And we need honesty. There will be electric, there will be gas, there will be hydrogen, but where? And listen to the operators to put a proof tag to it, test it, and then we can talk about where we put the money to good use near.
I mean, I think just responding on some of that, I mean, I hear a lot of different arguments for and against all of these different technologies and systems. I mean, ultimately, where we're going as a bank, as a public bank, is that we are looking at the impact of our project on the climate in absolute terms. So, you know, is a technology still emitting carbon? And if so, what can we do about it? Has to be the question we ask. And that, I'm afraid, applies to very efficient public transport operations run by diesel at the moment. You know, we've been supporting those in the past. Will we support those in the future? Well, that's an open question at the moment. Because the modal shift argument, the prevention of shift away from public transport, as well as, you know, shifting people onto public transport, it works both ways, is a good thing. But it's a good thing in relative terms, because public transport, efficiently delivered, still has a carbon footprint. So if we're talking about going to, you know, 90% or 100% reduction, which is the ambition, then, you know, we have to see incremental improvements in carbon emissions. And that means that some of the things that Matthias is talking about is absolutely right. Efficiency, absolutely. You know, empty vehicle kilometers are a big problem in the trucking industry. All of these things can be addressed, and they are relatively quick wins. How easy they are is a different question, but if we could mandate that to happen, yes, it would improve efficiency. But at some point, you are still faced with systems that emit carbon. And the question is, how do we substitute for those? And the you know, from a financing perspective, from an economic perspective, what you don't want to do is jump into, let's just land on LNG trucks. You don't want to jump in, invest hugely in LNG supply, refueling, massively buy trucks from Volvo and its competitors. You know, if in 15 years' time, actually, we turn around and go, oh, but LNG still emits carbon.
15 or 50?
15, probably.
1.5.
The amount of change that is expected from us in the next 25 to 30 years is astounding.
But may I ask, what will we achieve in 10 or 15 years? Lars, one of our hauliers just wanted to order 10 electric trucks from you. And I shouldn't maybe say this, but it's a general concern. You're now switching on the production. The answer was you can have 5 in the entire next year. And I told you that we buy 1,000 trucks an hour.
Yeah.
So we have a real issue in terms of capacity and availability as well.
But the elephant in the room is China. I mean, we were told a minute ago to ignore the Chinese, but we ignore the Chinese at our peril. I mean, in the bus market, the Chinese now have, what, 400,000, 425,000 buses running? Europe's got, what was it, 4,500? You know, we are facing an industrial revolution with production having shifted to China. And China is, if we give them the opportunity, and we might, it's a political decision, but they will do to us what we've been doing to them for the last 40 years. They'll be selling us vehicles.
But then you confirm, we have 1 million buses, whereof 60 are urban and 40% are long distance coaches, incoming urban traffic. And you have, what, I say I'm wrong, 300 million cars? So where's the problem? I'm just asking openly.
Let me just bring in Axel first of all how do you incentivize more and support more?
First, I wanted to come back to what Neil was saying. I think he's absolutely right. I mean, under this commission, with this parliament and this council, we have put in place sort of the emission framework for manufacturers for 2030, also for trucks. And so it is clear that the sector needs to find a solution to comply with that. And that gives you certain indications for the mix of fuels that you should put forward, and also to be, as Neil was putting it, to put some caution on what is your long-term investment. Because at the same time, we now see, particularly driven by member states, by some member states, the push for the next cycle to go whatever the framework for 2040 and 50 will be. But the emissions will need to come down. We know that, and it's a need because we have to somehow cope with climate change and the threats it poses. You said it earlier. So that is a point where we need to have an honest discussion in the sector, you know? What is the potential that we can bring from the different technologies? And we are in the process of updating our alternative fuels report together with our joint research center to give some preliminary answers to that. And I think we need to have that discussion with everyone. And then it cannot be sort of, you know, we are now here and let's look what is feasible. I mean, that's a very sort of good starting point, but I agree with you. I mean, we need to take a little bit more a dynamic perspective and say, you know, what could change? Because all of us would agree 2 to 3 years ago, none of us would have expected the situation, the context of discussions we are in right now. And that's, of course, China is the point. I mean, 5 years ago, the Chinese were nowhere in the European bus market, and now we see them at what, 11, 12, 13, 14%. So, I mean, so this is why the Commission has also started to say, okay, one thing is climate, the other is industrial sort of development and policy. We need to see that together because we need a transport sector that is both sort of decarbonized but also competitive and, you know, still there.
And I bet the Chinese are not sitting discussing in panels. Yeah. They're getting on with it, aren't they? But Lars.
Neil, I think it's extremely important to moderate these kind of discussions. If we think that we should not support any kind of initiatives, any kind of technologies taking us towards the solution, if we think that we should sit and wait for the magic solution that will occur around 2030 something, then we will fail big time. Mm. So to say no to technologies that will take us towards the end stage, that would be dangerous for Europe.
No, I'm not disputing that at all. I mean, I see this very much as a technology transition. And like many others, I hope that there are solutions out there. I mean, you know, what Johan is describing about the evolution in the battery world, I mean, the hydrogen world has a lot to prove. They keep telling us that they're going to do it. I'm waiting to see. You know, and I'm looking for opportunities to support them. But, you know, it is a transition. And we saw this in the bus market. People started with 2 or 3 buses, and they ran them for a couple of years. And they went, oh, they're not so bad. And some people went, oh, they're horrible. I can't deal with them. You know, and the people who could have gone on and bought 50, 100, 150. And they're now running that as 10, 20% of their fleet. And they're doing, you know, they're coming back and saying, well, I'm going to do another 150. And actually, in the next 5 to 10 years, my fleet will go basically 100% electric or 100% alternative fuel. Some people are choosing gas. Okay. You know, there are regional reasons and historical reasons why some people prefer gas.
I'm using urban with private operators. The business case in an urban environment is totally different.
Yeah, but what you have to remember is that Europe is not a single market. Because if you go to the Scandinavian countries or the Netherlands or the UK, actually buses are a private market and they are private operators. I mean, Germany, yes. France, yes. Traditionally publicly owned, publicly operated services. And yes, they behave very differently. So again, you know, one of the beauties of Europe is its diversity. One of its weaknesses is its diversity.
Yeah. Over.
I will just add that by the end of the day, we are looking, because we are all specialists, I would say, from the transport sector, from the different parts of the value chain there. And we are thinking now in silo, because by the end of the day, when we talk about the electricity that we put in the cars, then we have, I would say, to look at the broader picture. And I think it's very favorable to use electricity in the cars because it helps us, I would say, in our strategy to build up more renewable capacity in Europe. Because by the end of the day, you need to have electricity which is greener. For gas, it's the same because more and more we have been seeing it. 12% of all the gas that is used already for natural gas vehicles in France is biogas. And if we look at our customers, it's 20% of our portfolio of customers who are using biogas. For LNG, it will be the same. We see that we have, inside in Italy because, I would say, the schemes there favor the development of bio-LNG. So I do believe that by the end of the day, the technology, in fact, will also evolve and bring us, and I would say, put more, I would say, greener energy into the mix so that we can use it and reach the targets. Hydrogen, we know that hydrogen today, if you look, I would say, at some fleets of taxis that use hydrogen in Paris, they are using gray hydrogen. But nobody, I would say, complaining about this because it's a major evolution to have hydrogen fleets of taxis in Paris. And I think, personally, that it's very good to showcase that, yes, hydrogen, I would say, is running. But the thing is, it's a path, it's a transition, in fact, for us to go to green hydrogen, where green hydrogen, in fact, will be, I would say, make sense in terms of economical terms and also make sense in terms of your investments, because I know that it's quite heavy and that the results are not yet here in terms of the value chain. So by building on this and having this whole vision and connecting, I would say, the usage of the fuels that are to be clean fuels, we can connect, I would say, to, I would say, the matter of energy, how we produce it, and also how we keep also, I would say, industry and employment here in Europe.
I want to say, because I hear hydrogen all the time, I believe, of course, hydrogen is also going to fuel some is electricity, so you think it's all great and fine, just the cost of the whole, of the fuel cells. But the trouble is, how do you get to the hydrogen? And there are two ways. You can make it from fuel or gas. That's the way it's done today. So today, if you drive hydrogen, you're burning, it comes from gas. So with a very inefficient process, you can make hydrogen. It's not a very good thing to do. The second thing is, you can make it from electricity, electrolysis, pressurize it, get it in a fuel cell and all of these things, or burn it in a combustion engine. But it's still super inefficient. People forget that. Inefficient to go from making it, getting it in a clean way, and getting it to the car. Super inefficient. We forget that. So I agree with you. We have to look to not only energy density, how do I make the fuel and how is it, but in the end, burning something which is not generated by the sun, I mean, not by a fossil fuel, but burning something in the end is not good unless you make it from an alternative fuel. And we forget that all the time. So this has to be part of the equation. And I also agree today for the industry, the CO2, it's almost a crime for me as a human person that CO2 is so cheap. Okay, it's not good for the sector. But CO2 is cheap. You can burn and burn and burn, and you pay hardly anything. It's a crime. Now, we are in a global space. Of course, if China doesn't care and US doesn't care, of course, then Europe will not be competitive. But it's a crime. We are killing ourselves, and there is no cost to CO2.
Do we have any other questions from the floor, please? Matthias.
No, just the argument of efficiency. It's an undisputed fact that the electric engine is the most efficient engine. But the more battery and weight you put on the vehicle, the energy goes south. The energy efficiency goes south, and that is also a fact. And that is why you have to carefully assess how far do you want to drive with an electric truck in order to still benefit from efficiency. But if you consider that 4 tons of batteries are needed to replace 100 liters of diesel, let's have a discussion on efficiency.
I hear always technical arguments. Maybe
you
yes.
You have to. You have
maybe
to
yes, maybe no. In the end, no matter what, in the end, if you take a fossil fuel, no matter where it comes from, and you burn it, you have CO2. That's physics.
And that we have to stop. What about the situation of the grid, if we are talking about electric vehicles really taking hold? I mean, you know, we're starting in the car world. What preparations are being made, and how will that ever be dealt with?
Well, what the grid operator says today is that, I would say, with the few numbers of electric vehicles that we have in the system today, there is no issue. I think the special issue regarding, I would say, what we call the balance of the electricity grid is usually, in fact, at the peak. So when you come back at night at home, so let's say around 7 p.m., usually, in fact, you switch on the light. When you are in winter, you put on the heater when they are electric, and you plug in your car. And so it means that it's putting, I would say, a high demand onto the grid, and in certain conditions, it may cause it to collapse, and then you could have a blackout. Today, the grid operators say there is enough capacity to absorb the numbers of electric vehicles that you have on the grid in cities, because it's well dimensioned, and it should be fine. Tomorrow, when we will have, I would say, 1 million, 5 million in one country of electric vehicles, and in France we have today 150,000 electric vehicles, so it's not an issue. When we'll have 1 million, 5 million, if everyone plugs at the same time at 7 in the evening, this is an issue. Yeah. The way to do it is, in fact, to go, I would say, through the digital place and to shift, I would say, the time when you are charging, meaning that everyone does not need to charge, I would say, when he comes back at night at 7, but possibly during the night for the needs that it have. And it will be through that digital play and all the charging station, and I'm sure at ABB you also have them. There is, I would say, this kind of digital software that helps, I would say, the user, I would say, schedule the time when he was charging and alleviate the congestion on the grid. When you go to highways, it will be another issue, because by the end of the day, you are along corridors, and usually you are in the countryside, so I would say fueling stations, if they become charging stations, they're in the middle of nowhere. So it means that you will have to put a special transformer, take from the medium on high voltage there, convert it, and if you want to deliver what we have, 350, 500 kilowatt, it needs, I would say, a lot of power just for this. And for this one, I think it's becoming an issue. And clearly, I think this is something, in fact, to be looked at, because by the end of the day, if you want to electrify along the corridors, it means that you need to reinforce the transmission and distribution grid, in fact, to get there, I would say, along the highways. And clearly, it can cause, I would say, for the grid operators, I would say, issues in terms of investment that would be needed, because by the end of the day, I would say, people and transport companies will be charging at the depot at the beginning, will be charging at destination. They will be charging en route, but it's not sure that it will make, I would say, a business case for the fueling station operator there.
Axel, you wanted to come in?
No, I just wanted to echo, I mean, for light duty vehicles, I mean, no one will doubt that this will be a challenge, but the good news is, I think we all agree we have the tools, we just need to make use of them, and that is smart charging. I mean, I think we're discussing heavy duty here, and I think there we have a little bit of a different picture. And I agree with Matthias. I mean, we have to discuss a little bit, maybe not on urban or interurban, because what I see is, you know, 100 kilometers, 150 kilometers, you have these sort of prepositions of battery electric trucks that you can charge them in the morning in the depot, they can make the round and come back. But if you go like 300, 350 kilometers, with a battery truck, I mean, we're really speaking in, is it worth exactly to have four? It could be. People could say, well, I want to have 4 kilos of battery on the truck for that and that reason. I don't know. But I mean, we know trucks are optimized for cargo, etc. So we'll have to see, will it be road electrification? It has been discussed for 20 years. You know, it's being tested. We don't know. Will it be? So I think trucking is really a bit specific compared to the other road segments. Totally. And there we still, you know, and the problem I see is that we'll need to get the emissions down quickly, because we see they are rising also from the trucks. But we don't have yet the answer to it. Maybe. And we have limitations. Yeah.
If we don't do it, the Chinese will do it, I think. So I think it will happen, and clearly long-haul truck will take longer time, because the cars are not ready. It will probably be another 2-3 years. But you will see the first Tesla semi-trucks in the US running this year.
The Chinese are doing a lot of things, including hydrogen. By the way,
I think they're wrong on that part.
Yeah, but you just highlighted that China will. Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so let's see what happens. But the I believe from a technology point of view, I can only talk about infrastructure. We can talk about the grid. The grid is not the issue. Yes, the high voltage line can support it. Maybe the last mile we need to look. It's not the biggest issue. Technology is there, at least from the charging infrastructure.
I think on the OEM side, there's quite some development ongoing. Of course, shorter range there is where the action is right now. Longer range, that is probably a little bit longer. So the technology is coming together, maybe in a mix of technology, but it's happening. And then the question is, how do we make sure the right infrastructure is put in place at the right time?
I think it's extremely important for Axel to bring home. I mean, first, we cannot put a legislation in place stating minus 30% CO2 reduction 2030, which leads to electric vehicles, and then say, but we only believe that we will use them in the city centers. So, I mean, that's not consistent. There will be use of electric vehicles up to 300 kilometers. That's a fact. Or you go home and change the legislation.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah.
So, okay. But I just wanted to say.
So, what's the answer?
Thank you.
What's the answer? Change the legislation?
Or? No. We will not change the legislation. But just to say, I mean, one thing is also we should keep in mind, we should not discuss this from a static technology perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Also, in view of the battery developments. I mean, we see now a lot of investment, and thankfully, and I think it's really also a good European thing that we have been seeing over the last 2 years evolving under the Battery Alliance, not only in battery and battery cell development for passenger cars, but also for other applications. So to now say, you know, we can predict what the battery in 5 to 10 years' time will be capable of doing is, you know, not possible, but I'm pretty sure that we will have much more potent. So the 300 kilometers. So the main question I have, and that's not, you know, we put the legislation into place and then we cannot deliver. The main question is, what is the recharging strategy and what are the implications for the network?
Absolutely.
And with the 350, I think we are on a way that we can together discuss. If we speak about 2 megawatts, I think then we are in a completely different program. And I agree with you. It might be even feasible, but it will require a much stronger overhaul of the system. And on that, you know, I at the moment only see that manufacturers are discussing plugs, etc., but we're not discussing the system integration.
That's not true. So an important element is, of course, let's avoid to have different plugs like we had in the past. That to me is already super important. We have one plug. That would be fantastic. We're getting there, luckily. The next thing is, of course, how do you integrate it in the grid? From the supply side, I think there is plenty of energy. The question is it clean? Is it green enough? Okay, hopefully in the future it will be cleaner. And it will, but then the question is how do I bring it to the site? The high voltage grid is strong enough in Europe. I think that is pretty much okay. It's really the last miles. And that's standard technology. 10 megawatt transformer, I mean, that's really a piece of cake. It requires some planning. But that is money, but that is not something which is exotic. Mm. It's standard stuff, which is done by companies like us and others every single day. So that's not special.
Matthias. Could I just come in? I totally agree with you, Johan, that just to pick up on hydrogen and an integrated approach on sustainability, that you shouldn't produce hydrogen from steam reforming of natural gas, then you're 10 times worse than diesel. Exactly. We agree on that.
Yeah.
But what we don't talk about is also the carbon backpack of a battery. If you produce a truck of 300 kilometer range, you will de facto have 60 tons of CO2 emitted for only producing the battery if you consider plus minus 100 kilograms for the production of one kilowatt hour. The human being is emitting in Europe roughly 11 tons being alive for an entire year, more than 60 tons of a single battery. I come back to life cycle, I come back to well to wheel. If you look at zero emission and the discussion is limited to what comes out of the tailpipe, we will fail on our climate targets big time. And then the question back to gas, you can wait for a better solution. I could say the best is the enemy of the good. But do you want to reduce now 20% and make use of inroads that you make with the technology? Or do you want to push now hard for something which in reality is actually leading to an increase of CO2 emissions? So we all have to do better, but my pledge is we all need these solutions together.
May I react?
Yes.
You throw a lot of numbers about this and that. Maybe they're right, maybe they're wrong, I don't know. But let's then do a fair comparison. I agree with every single part, the production of the energy, the production of the batteries, the production of gas. Let's put it all in one equation and then see.
Maybe you're right. I don't think so. But let's use all the numbers and then conclude.
Yes, I mean, Matthias, you are quoting a lot of numbers, but you are perhaps
true numbers, by the way.
I'm not disputing them at all.
And if we don't talk facts and figures, I'm very sorry. We will stay on an emotional debate.
But I think the point that Axel made was that this is not a static technology. And you heard the woman from Schenker who was talking in the thing saying that you have to dare to act. And in a way, you sound as an industry that you are really a bit putting your head in the sand and saying, look, we want to help. But actually, that won't work for us, and that won't work for us. And
we will use electricity, we will use hydrogen, and we will continue to use gas. That's what I'm trying to say. There is not a silver bullet ticking all the boxes, and that's, I think, also what Lars tried to indicate. Yeah. And I also do believe that the combustion engine will survive, and we need better fuels, which is why IRU wants to see a new CO2 methodology for new trucks putting in the market as of 2025, namely a well-to-wheel approach.
Okay.
From my point of view, I mean, I like what you were saying, because we should have a discussion about the different use cases in the sector and which technology we can use over the next 5 years, over the next 10 years, with what kind of effect. And I think because we don't have one transport heavy-duty sector. And when you now say, 300 kilometers, we'll see that we can also use battery electric and potentially also fuel cell electric in the longer term. I think that is already a different discussion than we had, 2 years ago, which is promising. And then let's have that use case by use case and come up with a sort of strategy where we can compare the different things, but not make one metric for all and throw numbers up where we are sure that they are not matching, because everybody has his or her numbers.
So coming up with a strategy then, I mean, who should be leading this whole thing? I mean, because there is so many, it is so immensely complex, that has become very clear in this conversation. Who should be leading? And if we're talking about investments, should it be public-private? I mean, Neil, what's your thought?
Well, I mean, the traditional view is that the industry brings forward the projects, the financiers support them if they think that there's some money to be made, and the regulator makes sure that we all behave ourselves. I think what's happened is that the boundary conditions of the game have been changed, and this overriding question of climate has been put at the top of the list. The question for us all is how do we respond, and what do we understand by it? And then who's going to bear the cost? I mean, the Paris Agreement acknowledges disruptive change is required. I mean, this is the disruption we're talking about. I mean, Matthias is articulating the pain of the operators who don't know what to do next. They go off in one direction only to be told it's better to go in another. I mean, that's not commercially sustainable. So ultimately, I think the view the bank has is we have to support a basket, a range of different solutions, a range of different technologies. We've been partnering with the Commission to get some grant money available. We've been getting some risk capital available. And then certainly in the bus sector, this has been paying some dividends. So I think there needs to be leadership all round. And I think even the corporates themselves are subjected now to shareholder activism. The corporate social responsibility thing is kicking in, where people are saying, well, I don't want to invest in fossil fuels. I don't want to invest in a company that abuses X, Y, and Z. So, they're beginning to feel, if you like, the emotional pressures. Because this is the other thing that I've been finding reasonably difficult to deal with, is the emotional side of the debate. You've in front of you, you've got a panel of very rational people, and we've all got our own points of view, and we've all got our different interpretations. But we all agree broadly on the game, yeah? But then somebody will pipe up from civil society, and maybe there's some of you here today, and will say, this is going to, if you're buying new trucks, what's happening to the old ones? If they're not being scrapped, well, you're perpetuating the problem. So surely we should have a scrapping ban. And then you go into this long, complicated explanation about how these vehicles are better than the ones that are in Africa and Asia. And you're lost, absolutely lost, because it's too long-winded, and you haven't caught the emotion. You know, the emotion is these things go to Africa, they rot, they get, you know, taken apart by little boys, you know, who are being abused, and you know, we're done, you know.
But in a way, is the emotion always bad? I mean, can't it also be driving the argument?
But I think it is driving the argument, which is why we're having a little bit of trouble as technical people to respond. Because we're saying, well, it depends on this and that and the parameters. And of course, you know, there are all these options and we have to be very careful. And I mean, the climate activists who are demonstrating every Friday at the moment would just cry, I think.
How are you under pressure, Lars, from shareholders? I mean, what's the situation? I mean, Volvo has a...
We are always under pressure from our shareholders. Have always been, will always be. And they definitely, they should have that expectations on us. So that's not something strange. But they are definitely part of this change. And we are lucky in our company because we have shareholders, understand owners, understanding the necessity of investing in research and development. Meaning that I am never saying internally or externally that I am underfinanced. I have colleagues in other industries sitting crying, talking about that the owners don't understand. We don't have that situation. Our owners understand how much we need to invest, absolutely.
So. Okay, so strategy then. Where do you know what would you like to see then, Matthias? Then, if let's get crystal balls out and say, you know, this is what we want to see happen now from this moment on. What's the most important thing that happens?
Acknowledge that road transport is essential for the society and for the economy as its main driver. Let the industry innovate itself. Earmarking is key. Invest road user charging in new technologies. Bring clarity based on a scientific and fact number-based, very clearly, discussion to what can you actually use where best. Operators are agnostic to what to use, but they need guidance. And right now there is a lot, also from manufacturers, Lars, if I may, there is not a consistent message that we receive on platooning, on overhead wiring versus battery. How can you bring any stability to the discussion if we are all doing a little bit here and a little bit there and you all want to sell something, and the market is huge, you can sell a lot because road transport will grow quite substantially. So 60% commission numbers is even conservative. We look now at the One Road, One Belt, China, EU, there's going to be lots of trade, and I repeat, over thousands of kilometers. There is uptake of maritime, aviation and rail, but there is even more uptake on the road, equally so. And distances are about 6,000-7,000 kilometers when you do trade on the road. And I don't need to tell you again what that means in terms of having a sensical discussion, in terms of what makes scientifically sense, and that most importantly also somebody in China and Europe is doing so that we can make the interconnections. As I told you, external EU borders, half of the trucks have an EU license plate. So it's far more complex than just saying it's going to be electric tomorrow. And who's paying the price? That's my last comment. Are you prepared to pay twice? I don't know what you paid for your lovely costume, but would you be prepared to pay 3 or 5 times more for it? Because it's not about what operators are willing to invest. Will this water cost twice tomorrow because we will push for a technology which is more costly? Be my guest. But it's a question to the society, and it's far more complex than just asking the operator, what are you willing to accept?
Okay, well, just...
Raise the price with 2%, and you have the answer.
And at least we can survive as a species.
Ironically, we should discuss what should be the price for transport. But
just
I think
the cost of transport for that bottle is a fraction.
Yeah. Voila. Yeah. But should it be increased?
Remove the sticker and you have it.
It's local water.
Let's just sort of come to an end in a way. I'll take that as your final point, Matthias, of course. But let me ask you all, but very briefly, what is the most important thing to get right now to move forward in this very complex world? We're talking mainly about the infrastructure needed for fueling and in the future. What needs to be really the most important thing? So who should I go to? I mean, Overit.
Sure. I think we'll be the third contributor next year regarding, I would say, the previous DAFI. let's have a look at, we'll say, what worked and what didn't work, and have a clear discussion on this, and to say, look, certain countries, in fact, had moved along. We cannot say that they did nothing. I would say there is a great contribution with the DAFI, and some countries, in fact, moved along, and there were some conversions. So already, I would say, both for cars, but also for heavy-duty vehicles, you have, I would say, already clean vehicles that are driving on the roads. The question is how to capitalize on this and how to prepare the next directive, in fact, to be even more efficient so that we reach our targets. So for me, there is also a question on how to harmonize when we have picked up the best practices. And what I would like also is to end a bit of all these discussions, because we see and we practice all the different kind of energy. So there is no better in one better energy than the other. The question is for which usage, and I come back to the question, how is it, I would say, easy to use for our customers? How is it also economically sound for our customers? How are they ready to adopt it? And I fully agree with your point, Matthias. Is the customer of our customer ready to pay for it? It means us.
Okay, from the bank's perspective, Neil.
Well, we need to see lots of good projects. So we need to see industry bringing forward sensible projects. I mean, we're an unusual institution in that we're a public bank. So we're looking at these things through a public policy lens. We're looking at it very much through a climate lens now. So we will prioritize what we hope are the best things for the climate. We work quite closely with the Commission. We channel some of their money. Maybe they'll choose to make more available for this transition. I mean, these are the trade-offs that the Commission has to work out. So it's a new Commission. They'll take a little bit of time. So, I mean, I think that's, you know, to reinforce the message is that, you know, we're here. We have hopefully an intelligent technical view of the projects, and we're very happy to discuss with industry when they're ready.
Johan.
Okay, for me it's very simple. It will happen anyway, even without subsidy or legislation. It will happen anyway, if we like it or not, and it will be electric. Let's see, come back in 5 years. But it will happen anyway. The real question is, do you want to excel it? Yeah. Can we use the Commission to excel what's happening? And yes, there will be a fight about weight and this and the range and all of that stuff. But it will be solved. We're solving it. We're solving it, the OEMs, infrastructures, utilities, we're solving it. Question is, can we excel? And I don't know how we should do that. Is it by putting some legislation that by that year you have to do this and that? I don't know. I'm not a politician. It will happen. But I hope the Commission can excel it, because we cannot afford it.
Commissioner, how can you excel? And will you have trucks at the centre of your revised directive?
We don't have trucks at the center of our revised directive per se, because, I mean, we're discussing infrastructure here, and obviously we're looking to light duty and heavy duty applications in all the segments. So obviously trucks will play a more, I mean, infrastructure for long distance haul will play a more important role than it has played in the past, because there it was not really that much discussed. I think we have two things to clearly consider here. One is we have a much broader discussion for the whole of the transport sector. And that is in view of the next 30 years and in view of the need to get to a sort of climate neutrality, decarbonization by 2050, we have to discuss the future fuel base of the whole transport sector. And you could see from the emission letter that the transport commissioner has been tasked to come up with a new comprehensive transport strategy, and solving that riddle, I mean, or addressing that riddle at least, will be one of the elements, including all other kind of baskets of measures that we need, because we also have safety and security and affordability, and we all discussed this. And then when it comes to DAFI and the review, I mean, you see, in a way you put it right to the point. I mean, the manufacturers are developing their plugs, the manufacturers are developing their recharging points, but when it comes to the systems integration, everybody points to the legislator and say, and now you do. And I think that's not how we can do it. This is why I said, I agree with you that, you know, let's have a discussion about the use cases in heavy-duty transport, and to what extent, for example, we can, over the next years, realistically assume electrification go. And if you say, okay, well, we don't see a problem, you know, we can push this out, then you know, we'll have a frank discussion as part of the overall policy making process and see what we can take. But for now, I think it is premature to say, you know, we should do X or Y or Z in that particular field. I think we need to still keep open the diversity of the technologies for the different use cases and have to find a way to ensure that we have both quality and quantity in terms of infrastructure. And I think there, you know, we're looking to Volvo, we're looking to others to continue the discussion with us. But it will be important to get, I agree, Darfi right on this.
Okay. Lars, you, the last word is with you, and we have 1 minute.
1 minute,
3 seconds.
And counting. 1 minute there to go. Yeah. So the bouquet of solutions, there will be many flowers in the bouquet, definitely, and I've said it several times. We are fortunate, we have a budget of 2 billion euros per year, 12,000 engineers. We can do a lot on our own. We have fantastic products in the pipeline. The one thing that we really cannot control, because I'm not worried about the uptake of LNG, for example. That will happen, and it's happening, and it will be thousands of vehicles. It is the uptake of the electric vehicles. It's the infrastructure connected to that. And that we don't end up saying that it was a pity we didn't meet the legislation because we didn't plan for, we didn't have a good plan to come up with the necessary infrastructure. So I'm extremely glad for the invitation, Axel. We will have further discussions on use cases and explain to you where to use different technologies. 4 seconds to go. Fantastic. A fantastic panel.
And there we are, zero. Thank you very much indeed for all your thoughts. A really spirited discussion. Thank you very much indeed. So, yes, Axel, you're going to have everybody knocking on your door now. That's it. You've got your committee here, and you can continue with the same people. Well, thank you all very much indeed for being here. You've heard that there's a lot of push for this new legislation, and the general consensus that there isn't a silver bullet in terms of what we need in the future, apart from Johan, who's convinced that it will be electric, but...
We'll see.
He's thrown the gauntlet down. In 5 years' time, we'll be back here and
absolutely.
We'll be able to really decide. And the thing is that you talked about low-hanging fruit. That was your thing.
And listen to the operator. Yeah, listen to the user.
But you want to, and smart legislation is really, really important. So a lot to think about, a lot to go ahead and a lot of action needed probably to make it all happen, but thank you. And thank you all very much for being here, and I think we have a lunch that is served outside, is that correct?
15 minutes.
Oh, we have 15 more minutes. Oh, well, do we have to keep talking for 15 minutes? Well, I don't, do we have any more questions? Oh, we've got our Twitter bird. Did we have a question? Sorry, so don't go anywhere, guys.
So from @DigitalJamma, to Axel Volkeri, AFID sets targets for public charging. What are your views on boosting semi-private charging in urban and regional areas?
Okay. So it's a very important question, and it's a very tricky one, because we're speaking about the type of infrastructure that you find in the fronts of supermarkets, cinemas, etc. So where it is clear that you can access it, but only you're sort of a client of that supermarket or a client of that cinema. And it is too early to say. We have clearly identified this topic. We have got a clear response from the market as part of our discussions, for example, through our Sustainable Transport Forum, that we need to address this area of semi-public infrastructure, and we will work a lot on that in the months to come, but I think for the moment it's a little bit too early to say. But of course, it will be an important part of the overall, mainly urban infrastructure to recharge sort of light-duty vehicles. Not so much. I would look to Volvo or others to see how they see that for the heavy-duty use applications. But there, I think we'll have more.
It will be rather crowded outside that restaurant.
Yes, exactly. So, but it is a very important question, a very important topic that we will need to consider further.
The microphone there, please.
My turn.
Good morning, Anders Berger from Volvo. Just some insight on the semi-public charging for trucks. We believe that to be vital, actually, because in logistic hubs and terminals, that would be kind of a semi-public. It will not be open to everyone, but probably contractually shared by the operators of that hub and that terminal. So that is an extremely important point to help trucks reach those 300 kilometers a day, because just for you, Matthias, also, I mean, we know from 2011 that the majority of transports in Europe are below 300 kilometers on road freight. So that's what we're aiming at now. And the small tail of the missions that are long, they need the semi-public and public charging infrastructure. But the majority of the energy of these majority of trucks of Europe will be charged overnight at their home state. That's not a big problem. We're talking perhaps 50 kilowatt maximum of power for each truck, but it needs one charging point per truck. So the numbers are great, but the powers are not that great. And let's look at from now to 2025. I think it's important to act now, Axel, because we are facing a sort of valley of death here now, because the trucks are entering the market as we speak. From us and from our competitors. And from now to 2025, we need to build that market. We need to build that infrastructure, because in 2025, we need to meet the legislation. And then we need some percent on the market. So I think that's important to bear
in mind. No, just to get this straight, and I fully agree with you, it's time to act. And I stress 2030, which is already ambitious, and I stress 2050, which is even more ambitious, so we have no time to lose. We just need to ensure that when we come with a proposal, that it is the right proposal that addresses sort of the needs of the market, but is not under or overshooting it. And I'm pretty glad to get your information on sort of that part of semi-public infrastructure, which is indeed true. I mean, we're looking into more complex and co-shared infrastructure solutions across industry, which is a very important point to for the further uptake of these vehicles.
Can I just pick up what Anders said, because I think it's very important, Anders. You just said that for the majority or the totality even of those trucks that can do 300 kilometers, you would charge at the base overnight. So I think we have now, you have contributed a quite interesting element and food for thought for the revision of DAFI. If we should push for high voltage charging on the 10T network on the motorway, and you just indirectly said maybe not, because it's base charging, and that would be very successful because it's executed as well with bus fleets and depots. So the depot approach is very successful, and we have a lot of good experience with the bus lanes in cities. We're also plug-in hybrids. When you have a bus lane of 30 kilometers or 40 kilometers, and you're going charged in the beginning and you recharge in the end. So this whole depot concept, that's a no-brainer. And I just think that the most important for operators, if I may, is the price of the kilowatt hour. High charging in cases that we know from cars, the price per kilowatt hour can be 40, 50, or even 60 cents per kilowatt hour. If you want to be competitive compared to diesel, you have to bring it into the corner of 10 or less. So there's quite an issue to be solved. And taxi, I just visited, we also represent taxi industry, the electric fleet of the airport in Amsterdam. Do you believe they charge electricity somewhere publicly? No, they do it behind their fence, otherwise there is zero business case, and they would never have done it because they are treated as an industrial client, because the charging station on the other side of the fence, the price would go 5-6 times higher.
Well, not surprisingly, Johan wants to come in there.
Well, the case, this is exactly the use case for cars, trucks. There is no secret. We know exactly where you charge. We know where cars charge, we know where buses, and we know exactly where trucks will charge. And guess what, where they charge? Where the cheapest energy is. And where is that? Maybe at that premises. You're absolutely right. So these trucks will be charged overnight, and maybe, if needed, they will go to more expensive energy. But that's also what's happening today. That's also what we're doing for fast charging for cars. The high power network for Ionity in Europe, which is also with some contribution from the European Commission. The whole idea is only when you need it. And when do you need it? Maybe 5% of the time or 10% max.
And this is exactly the same for trucks. So we don't need that much. It's not such a hard nut to crack, but we still need infrastructure. But it's only a limited amount of charging stations at some strategic locations, which is maybe 5% of the energy. So it's not a big, it's not a big task.
I will just add one thing, is that by the end of the day, it comes back to the question of the use cases. Clearly, I would say we need to have this clear discussion with, I would say, around the table to identify the use cases where it applies, where it's profitable, in fact, for the users, in fact, to run it profitably. As we said, you said electric, I would say, from the beginning, we have been saying a urban city center for the cars, for the delivery on the last mile. Then by the end of the day, clearly it's electric if you have to access the city center. I would say for the other car, other use cases where you are going, I would say long range driving, it's quite different. So it means that by the end of the day, I would say clearly we need to have this discussion, I would say early 2020, on the use cases and have a clear discussion, and to remain, as we said, in fact, technology and energy neutral, because by the end of the day, it's really, in fact, the user who will adapt the solutions. If it's not comfortable with them, if they are not comfortable with either the economics or the usage by itself, they will never adopt it and we will miss the targets.
Have we just agreed on where to invest? I just want to keep that for the record. Charging for urban and depot and gas and hydrogen for motorway and long distance, is that what we said?
Well, I think if
my you last are saying
words,
yes.
My last words on this. Let's look to cars. It's exactly the same. We had cars, then we had buses, and now we have trucks. We learned from the past. What's the problem today with cars? Why don't we have more electric cars? Not because of the charging infrastructure. That's there. It's just we need more cars. We need more affordable cars. I think the two go hand in hand, but putting the infrastructure is not the biggest challenge. Okay, it takes a little bit of time, but we need, and here, of course, we need affordable trucks with decent range. Of course, the pricing will go down. It will take time, but they will come. So in the end, is there an affordable truck that your use case, your business case, your TCO is right? That will happen. The question is how quickly, but the technology is there. Is the pricing of the technology at the right point? Maybe not yet, but we will get there. And again, can Europe help here to excel, I think? But infrastructure, we get it on. We get it on.
Yes, please.
Yeah, hi, good morning. My name is Solène Messonnier. I work for Alstom here in Brussels. I would have two remarks and one question very quickly. My first remark is that I agree with Axel. We don't know what the future has in store when it comes to battery performance. So I think it's really important that the EU keep spending money on research and innovation there, especially as now we are deciding on the next generation of partnership. So I think in particular of EGVIA, the Green Vehicle Initiative, which is going to be a 2-0 partnership. My second remark is about the correlation between range and size of battery. At the moment, it seems that the bigger the range, the bigger the battery in the truck. But as you may know, we have developed, and I think, Matthias, you touched upon it at the end, we have developed systems of dynamic charging where you can charge the truck while it's in motion. And there you can get rid of a bit of this constraint in terms of battery size and autonomy. And this is what we have done at Alstom with Volvo. We have developed a system where we charge truck from the ground. It's inspired from what we do in railways. And I come to my question, which is for Axel, and I was wondering if you would consider in the AFID revision, consider having this new metrics in terms of dynamic charging, because at the moment we speak of 1 point per X kilometer or 1 point per X vehicles, but when it comes to dynamic charging, this is not, it cannot be applied, it's not relevant for this type of charging. So that was my question.
Okay, thank good you. Point. Dynamic charging, will that be included in the directive?
As I said again, I mean, we are too early to speak about the concrete contents of the directive. I mean, you will understand all of that. I mean, we are following very closely all the different types of recharging infrastructure for, you know, electric trucks, and that includes the catenary solution, that includes the overhead solutions. The question is really, and I think that is part of the problem, and we are speaking here probably, I mean, that has become clear mainly about what is happening above 300 maybe kilometers. and in terms of range. And you have, I mean, it's a different thing to put an infrastructure with 2 megawatt, you know, ultra-fast or mega-ultra-fast recharging stations into the 10T, than to put sort of the necessary infrastructure for catenary dynamic charging. And one thing is you cannot probably do both because it's, you know, I mean, that's a little bit so. Maybe we also see a system evolve where we have in certain parts of the network where you have sort of a clear use case for catenary or overhead charging and equipment. But then again, you have the problem that the trucks, that the operator has to kind of equip the vehicle with the technology that he might not use a lot. And so from an economic perspective, why would you do that? I mean, why would you put an overhead pantograph on your roof if you only use it in parts of the net? So I think that's a little bit the problem that we have here. We have different technologies in very early stage, because I think also for the catenary, we are still at the demonstration site in Sweden, in Germany, in Italy. And it's a bit unclear, you know. So I think we will never make sort of a choice from a legislative point of view, you now need to put a catenary, or we'll probably include it as an option, whatever. But I mean, that I can say, I mean, it would be premature now to say, you know, the future is catenary dynamic charging.
Matthias.
I would like to turn the perspective a bit into how can you help operators. There is no financial mechanism in place which is incentivizing fleet renewal and uptake of alternative technologies from the operator point of view. CEF has limitations and a little overhead you can charge on trucks if you do LNG, electric, hydrogen. We know it, Neil, but it's not enough. And you could argue that the recent case in Germany where they have lifted the road toll for electric and gas, where you basically as an operator save 20,000 euros a year on the basis of 100,000 kilometer mileage, you could argue you created a business case, as also the Commission has criticized that decision, to actually include also gas next to electric. But what actually happened is, gas is now booming, and zero on electric because the products are not there. But would an operator invest in this only because there is a business case? No, because it works. So I would like to twist the logic a bit and argue, if you would incentivize fleet renewal much stronger from the Commission and Investment Bank point of view, I'm sure if you find an operator who says, hey, I want 1,000 electric because I know it works for me, I want 1,000 hydrogen or 1,000 LNG, you guys will be the first one to build it because you can create a business case and you will invest in infrastructure like this. I want to be a bit provocative, but twist the logic and incentivize fleet renewal much stronger.
Neil, what do you think?
I mean, it boils down to the availability of money at the end of the day. And you know, the one thing that governments don't have a lot of at the moment, it's money. You know, because we all feel we pay enough tax already. And there are lots of competing calls for cash. So, I mean, I think this is the problem that we face, is that we are trying to pilot the transition from one equilibrium to a new equilibrium. To paraphrase Adam Smith, it's the destruction of one industry for the rebirth of another one, and that's going to cost some money. And either private people lose money, the owners of the businesses, us as the consumers, or the government subsidize it, and then that's still us paying because we're the taxpayers. So, you know, yes, it's a complicated political set of political trade-offs.
More incentives for
maybe
fleets.
Just one more positive message here. I think Neil was alluding to that further on. I mean, if you take the heavy duty segment of the buses and the role of financing, I mean, what we see now under our loan and guarantee instruments, which is not grants, we see big projects coming. And I think that's a true, you know, nice, good development, because honestly, I think you should not depend on us, on our grants. I mean, we should be there in the initial stage, etc. But in the end, it should be a market-driven development. And so that is actually quite promising, because we now see in that heavy-duty segment, you know, and Volvo is right there, the buses are coming, and where there are more risky cases, there is a guarantee or a preferential loan. In some cases, we still have grants, etc. But it is working into that direction. And so I think we can initialize the same sort of dynamic in the other parts of the heavy trucking sector, but you know, let's have that strategy clear, let's have a little bit of a discussion around use cases, let's see what we need to do through AFID review and in a broader sense the transport strategy. And we have the tools, we have the self-blending facility, we have the self-calls, we can support this.
I'm also very optimistic that actually being a truly commercial market, trucking and logistics is once the elements are in place, actually it's going to go very quickly because it will make business sense to do it. Yeah. And I think that's ultimately what we're talking about is how do we find the starting blocks for industry to renew itself and to go low emission, zero emission. And how much is that going to cost them, and is there a business case for it? And once these elements are together, manufacturing plays its part with economies of scale. Government facilitates through regulation and targets. People like us help absorb some of the risks on a short-term basis. We don't need to do it forever. It should be a proper, it is currently a well-functioning commercial market. It will be again. How do we get them through it?
May I just add to this? This is exactly what happened. Cars, yes. Now there's no subsidy needed anymore. That works. Infrastructure that works. Buses, absolutely. So the growth of electric buses, it needed some help, but now it is very successful. So Paris is going to do 3,000 buses. We do a lot of projects in that space. And the truck, we are at the starting point. We are at that point. Mm. So I'm very optimistic that it will happen with the right technology, but I'm super optimistic that this is wave three, cars, buses, and now trucks. Super optimistic. I am.
Yeah, no,
maybe you not, so, but I'm super optimistic.
No, that was not the sigh of relief. It was
support.
Yeah, I fully agree with what you're saying, and I think that what Matthias is highlighting is that it should not only be a DAFI, it should be a DAFIV. Meaning that we also have with the same amount that we'll be able to allocate, not only to set up the infrastructure, but also set up the vehicles that will use it. Otherwise, it will be very difficult to meet our targets. And as you said, we need to kickstart, and then the market will kick in, and it will do its job. But by the end of the day, we also need, in fact, to have the users, being compensated by the extra cost that the new technologies and the new fuels adoption, in fact, we require.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. So this was a bit like an encore at the theatre, wasn't it? We'd already applauded you, and then you came back on again. But thank you very much indeed. It was great.
Thank you.
So now there will be lunch served, and thank you very much indeed for being here.